for some of us who shop on classified sites, we may have that fear that what we are buying does not belong to the person who's selling it to us. Today, I'm going to recount a story when that exact thing happened to me. And I'm going to start telling that story right now. Welcome back to the channel, everybody. My name is Chris, and you are watching The 11th Fret. For me, more often than not, through just a little bit of patience, I've been able to acquire used gear for far less than the current market value. But what happens when you find out that the guitar you bought has been missing for some time and the original owner has been looking for it? What happens then? What do you do? Do you keep the instrument? Do you try and return it? Do you turn it over to the police? Do you just hold on to it long enough and hope that no one comes sniffing around? Well, for me, I'm going to recall a story when this happened to me and how I found the original owner. Back in May of 2020, I was thumbing through a classified service just looking for a striking deal, something that would catch my attention, something that would stand out as something I could use on another guitar or I could build off of or turn around and flip and make a quick buck. There's a lot of reasons why I could go through a classified site. And it was late at night, I was tired, but I found this guitar. This body, if you will. There was no neck, it's just this body. And I recognized it, and it clearly was a NUNO Betancourt guitar body. This guitar had no neck, it was missing the Floyd Rose, but it still had its pickups. In the bridge position of this guitar, it looked like there was a Bill Lawrence 500 XL. In the neck position, it's supposed to have a Seymour Duncan 59, but it was unmarked and I couldn't quite tell. If that's the case, I just kind of felt that this might be a guitar worth investing in. Now, on this classifieds listing, it was only posted for $1. Well, I struck up a conversation with the seller. We exchanged pleasantries back and forth, and we talked a little bit about this guitar and what they wanted for it. And they were telling me they had other offers. They were getting $50, $60, $80 offers. And I looked at it and I was like, I feel like this guitar is going to need a lot of work. It's missing the neck. And the neck, I had a look right away, just searching Google, Reverb, eBay, you name it, every possible place you could find a guitar neck for a Stevens 5-bolt neck mount that allows for a higher reach on the fingerboard. It's a strange one, but it's very unique to NUNO's line of guitars. If you can find one at all, it's gonna cost you an arm and a leg, as I saw in previous listings. It's a very expensive and very unique neck. And I thought if I can get this guitar body for around $20, I can possibly flip it for a profit by mining the pickups out of it, if nothing else. I didn't really know what this guitar was. Admittedly, I know who NUNO Betancourt is. He's an icon. I was never a huge fan of his music, but I have enormous amounts of respect for him. I've watched a lot of his live performances on YouTube. He is a phenomenal guitar player. So in discussing the price with the seller, again, they were saying they were getting higher offers, but I said I can do about 20 for it because of all the work that's going to be required. I will come right now and come get it. But they weren't really responding back super quick. By the time I got a response, it was the next day, and they said, you can have it for $25. I thought, it's $5 difference. Of course, I can do that. So I agreed. They told me where to meet them, which was this park and ride in Sylmar, California. In my mind, I thought this park and ride was going to be something populated with a lot of buses coming and going and riders waiting to board, riders getting off. I just felt it was a very public place with a lot of people. By the time I arrived to this park and ride, which is probably about 10 miles away from where I live, it was pretty desolate. It was run down. It was filled with old beat up cars and trash all over the place and God knows what else. It was a very interesting place. As I pull up, I park in one of the parking stalls in this parking lot, and there's people in their cars doing their thing, and I'm trying not to be overly paranoid, but at the same time, I also park my car backed up against the fence, so it would be difficult for someone to sneak up. I messaged the seller and let them know I was there, ready to go, and I heard no response. I'm sitting there kind of tripping out about it. I'm wondering, is this a setup? Am I gonna get ambushed? I mean, this place was really, really neglected. So I finally get a message back. They say they're on their way, and the seller shows up walking their dog, which was a pit bull, and I see them carrying the body under their arm. So I knew the guitar was legit. I was probably not gonna get ambushed, but that's not always the case. That can still happen to anybody. You can get ambushed even with the merchandise being presented. So I was still on guard, looking over my shoulder because people were looking at me weird. I was trying not to be paranoid. I was trying not to get into my own head and overthink it, but it just was weird. Every time I glanced over at other cars, there were just eyes on me. So we made small talk. I introduced myself. Everything was cool. I gave them the $25 and they gave me the guitar body. We said a few other things that were nice and cordial, and I headed home. Back at home, I wasted no time diving into this guitar. I threw it immediately on the table, grabbed my screwdriver, and went to work. First things first, what are the pickups? Let's confirm that it's a Bill Lawrence. So I pulled the bridge pickup out, and sure enough, it's definitely a Bill Lawrence 500XL. Looks good, it tested well. And then I pulled out the neck pickup that was unmarked on the front. The bobbins had no markings whatsoever, but it was a black open coil humbucker. So I took it out, and on the bottom was the old school Seymour Duncan label, which is 59. And so I could see right away that these pickups were in line with this model of guitar. I still didn't know exactly which model it was. I wasn't quite sure if it was the N2 or the N4 or any other variation that might exist out there. And just like I saw in the photos, there was that Stevens neck joint, and again, that neck is next to impossible to find. And if you could find one, good luck. It's just gonna be a very, very, very costly neck. I wasn't sure if I wanted to put that kind of expense into this guitar. I didn't know what it was. It was a NUNO Betancourt guitar for sure, but still, I don't know what its value is as far as which model it would be. And also, if I'm gonna put a neck on it, it's not gonna be original anymore. So I can't sell it as an original article. I don't even know if there would be a buyer for something like that. So yeah, I thought mining the pickups out is probably the best course of action. But I still didn't touch this guitar. I didn't wanna desolder anything because this guitar still had some weird anomalies to it that just stood out to me as different. On the back, the control cavity plates were clear. You could see right in, they were plastic or acrylic, and inside it was just all copper shielded. It looked very, very well done. The wiring looked professional. And what really stood out to me is the output jack on the guitar. Normally on guitars, they have like a football plate or some sort of plate mounted on the outside of the guitar. The output jack was mounted on the inside of the guitar body, allowing the cable to be a little more recessed into the body. Either that's for protection, I don't really know what it was for, but it was different. I'd never seen a guitar really do that before. It was very clear that this guitar had some mods done to it. On the front, the volume pot, which is the only potentiometer on this guitar, had some sort of screw into it that would allow the volume pot to stop at this little catch. Very, very different. I'm not really sure why that was. It seemed like a way to have the previous owner dial in quickly their preferred settings. I didn't really get a chance to play with it enough to know why that was, but it was different. Everything about this guitar felt prototype-y to me. It was that point in time, I'm starting to think, is this NUNO Betancourt's old guitar? I don't really know. I decided to turn to good old Google. Start digging around. Look for articles that talk about NUNO giving this guitar away. Did he smash it or did it get destroyed? Did it get stolen? Did it, you know, I don't really know anything about it. I looked and I looked and I looked and I found nothing. I'm scouring everything I possibly can on Google, as amateur as I could possibly be. Digital articles were just not presenting the story I wanted. So I turned to Google Images at this point in time just to do a search for NUNO Betancourt. All I was looking for was to see this guitar body pictured with him in something in the sea of Google images. One of the things that was very distinctive about this guitar's body is that it has this beautiful vein running right down the middle. And that's something I don't think would be easily recreated because wood grain in itself is unique. And this had a very unique pattern to it. On the guitar I was holding, I was trying to compare that vein to the images. And sure enough, it did look very similar to what I found. And as I kept looking, I started noticing something that didn't stand out to me. I don't know why it didn't stand out to me, but there are two little dings on the top that were on the back side of the guitar by the rear strap button. So I thought, maybe those dings are on his promo shots. I doubt it, because the shots I'm finding were from the 90s, like between maybe like 91 and 95, back when Extreme, NUNO's old band, was riding their biggest wave of success. And these two little dings did match. I started seeing these dings on other promo shots. I saw these dings on his N4 that he was playing live at Wembley Stadium for Freddie Mercury back in 92. I started noticing this guitar next to him or him playing it. And then I thought, I wonder if he played it in a music video. And sure enough, this is the guitar he used in Extreme's Rest in Peace. I'm pretty certain it was. It looked very similar. I was scrubbing through and I'm looking for that same vein going through the body, and it looked to be that guitar. So at this point, my mind is blown. I'm fairly certain this is it. But I know my limitations. I know I'm an amateur. I am not an investigator. But again, I wanted to make sure that this guitar was Nuno's and also to find out what happened to it. Is it rightfully mine because I bought it? Do I need to return it? Any of those things could be a factor. But ultimately, I wanted to find out from more people first before I started reaching out. Then I turned to Reddit. I go to the subreddit for r/guitar. I just had to believe there was somebody out there who knew everything about the guy. And none of them really came forward, but I did have a lot of guitar enthusiasts who helped out. They chipped in and they found the same things I did, looking at the vein down the body, looking at the chips. Most of them agreed. They said, yeah, this is clearly the guitar that Nuno used to own. At this point, I'm pretty excited. This is cool. I have Nuno Betancourt's guitar, and I have no right to own this guitar because I'm not the biggest Nuno Betancourt fan, so if nothing else, this guitar is going to become a Nuno Betancourt fan's dream come true. So I still had a lot of questions. I still wanted to find out what happened. Where did this guitar come from? Again, is it rightfully mine? I turned to the local social media platform next door to reach out to my neighbors to find out if anybody here knows Nuno, because in my mind, I know Nuno lives somewhere in LA, and there's gotta be somebody in the area who works in media or in music production who knows how to get a hold of him, because I'm in Los Angeles too. I figured there's gotta be somebody. Kevin Bacon's 6 degrees of separation theory can't do me wrong here. And sure enough, a lot of neighbors came forward offering help, saying things like Nuno Betancourt is a client or he's part of this union, but that kind of fell flat for me anyways. I didn't get the information I was looking for, so I turned to Twitter and I asked this question, tagging Nuno, trying to get his attention. And I didn't get his attention like I thought. His manager found me because Nuno had recently been on a TV show, and so his manager was checking Twitter and all the other social media platforms for his mentions, hashtags to see if everything was positive. And he found me. So we DM'd back and forth, talking to each other about this guitar. We exchanged phone numbers and I got a phone call. We talked, it was wonderful. It was a cool exchange. We did confirm that this guitar was Nuno's. And this is that part of the story I can't fully divulge to all of you because it's not my story to share. Pressing forward with my part in the story, we do confirm that this is Nuno's guitar, and Nuno's been missing this guitar for quite some time. It was very important for me to get it back into his hands. I don't like people losing their gear, especially something like this, where I see this guitar in so many things, I'm almost convinced that this was Nuno's number one main guitar. At least at some point in his career, he seemed to play this thing an awful lot. I have to imagine it's very special to him. I wanted to get this guitar back into Nuno's hands, and I didn't want a courier to show up at my door to take the guitar away from me and then bring it to Nuno's house. I wanted to make sure it got to Nuno. It was that important to me. So we arranged for that. Everything was cool. Now, bear in mind, at the time that this was all happening, this is at the peak, that big wave of COVID in the United States. This is at that moment in COVID where we were all on stay-at-home orders. Everything was still crazy. There were lines forming outside of stores, limited people getting in. And at this point in time, my wife was having her birthday. Her sisters were gonna fly in from out of town. They booked an Airbnb. Everything was all planned. She was so excited about this. She just wanted to spend time with her sisters. And I was really excited for her to do it, and she's an ICU nurse as well, so we can kind of see where this story is going. Obviously, it made sense to cancel the flights. Her sister stayed home, she had to work like crazy, and every nurse was trying to maintain a shred of sanity throughout all of this. So in her world, everything was madness, and I thought, you know what would be cool is if Nuno could wish her a happy birthday in a video, something along those lines. And sure enough, Nuno was so cool, he filmed this long video to her that was kind of like a cameo, but way longer.
That's it. You know, I just wanted to say thank you, happy birthday, and also thanks to your man for reaching out and saying that he came across the body of my old guitar. It might not seem like much, but it's very sentimental to me. I used it for many years. It was a part of my life, a part of my history.
He wished her a happy birthday, thanked her for all she does, and he was very sweet. He complimented her, saying how beautiful she was, because I did send a picture, and she is very beautiful. He was so gracious. He really blew my mind. I was offered other things too, and they said, you name it, let us know, and I just was not of that character to try and take advantage of a situation of someone's loss, especially in that kind of caliber. So we arranged for me to bring the guitar to Nuno's house. I get the address. It's not very far from me. It's like 15 minutes away. Very, very close drive. I was told the date and the time to do it, so I got the guitar all boxed up, wrapped it up neatly, put it into a shipping carton just to make sure it had that added layer of protection. I put it in the car, I hit the road, and I set my destination to that address I was given. I show up, it's a beautiful house, and I ring the doorbell and nothing happens. I wait and I wait and I wait and I ring it again, nothing happens. So then I knock and I wait and nothing happens. And I'm sitting there thinking, am I in the right place? Because this is a nice neighborhood and I don't want to look suspicious. I have a box in my hand. I don't want to look like I'm stealing a package. So I wait for a moment. And then sure enough, I hear running through the house. Nuno opens the front door. And I was so excited to bring home this guitar to him because I knew this guitar was with him during the peak of his success in Extreme. So I handed the box to him. He was really, really grateful, super excited. I was hoping he would unbox it in front of me. So I was like, ready to film, and I was filming a little bit, and he was like, no, that's not cool. And I was just too excited to understand why that wasn't cool. And then I grounded myself and said, oh yeah, privacy, this is his house, this could reveal things. I totally got it. I calmed down. He didn't open it in front of me, but we spent about 10 minutes on his front porch just talking about stuff, and he was a super cool guy. I had my own hopes that he would at least unbox this guitar on his Instagram page or something along those lines. I thought it would be like a ceremonial thing that this guitar was returned home, he would be able to put it back together and put it back to use, all those things, because I know his other N4s and his 4Ns get a lot of use. The guitar I returned home to him was his N4 Paddock model. I don't know if this was a custom shop or a prototype. I didn't really get that information, but it was his, and it was definitely the guitar he played a lot in the early to mid 90s. And he said the neck had broken at some point. He just put it away. That's where my part of the story ends. So as I returned it back to him, we said our goodbyes and I drove back home, and I just had this nice warm sense of accomplishment that I returned something important back to Nuno Betancourt. And I talked with his manager on the way out. I got lots of thanks and praise and all that stuff. And it was a fun experience. Probably if it were any other recovered guitar, it would be a much different story. But this was Nuno Betancourt. This is an iconic guitar player who is very accomplished in his field. And he's someone I look up to and hope that one day I could just be a tiny shred of the guitar player he is. And I'm just glad I was able to play a role in the guitar's return. No, I didn't get $25 back. They did offer it and I declined it. I said, no, thank you. I'm just happy to get this guitar home. Nuno was cool. His manager was cool. Everybody was cool. But the story had never come out before. And I waited for the story to come out from their side. And it never did. I never saw the guitar appear. I never saw it on Instagram and I never saw it on Twitter. The guitar has never resurfaced on social media and he's never really talked about it. And I thought, you know what? I have the story and I really want to share it. I don't really have the proof that I returned it to him. But I do have the text messages, I do have the video, I have all those things, I have the exchange between his manager, that all out of the way. I also don't want to imply that anybody has done anything wrong, that the person I bought it from played a role in how the guitar disappeared to begin with. I don't know. They didn't even know what they had. They just knew it was a guitar. So this guitar could have just circled around through a bunch of people. Who knows? But they had it. I bought it from them. And yes, that part of the story was uncomfortable, buying it from a really weird park and ride. It was a lot of risk, but it makes for a great story. And that's why I'm telling this story today, because you know what? It is a great story. Some of you might look at that guitar or might know who Nuno Betancourt is in great detail. You know his career, you know his history, and may have always wondered, whatever happened to that N4 Paddock? Well, I had it for about a week. It was in my possession. I got to have this guitar that had donned the stage of Wembley Stadium to pay tribute to Freddie Mercury. That was in Washburn's promotional materials. That was in loads of magazines. That was part of his arsenal. Nuno Betancourt is a great guitar player and a really cool person. I loved meeting him. I was honored to be part of this guitar's return, and that's my story. All that aside, if you like content like this, make sure you hit the subscribe button and that little bell notification to be notified when I upload new content. Let me know in the comments below. Let me know what you think. Again, my name is Chris. You've been watching The 11th Fret. Thank you guys so much. We'll see you next time.